Thank you. Thank you very much. It's a wonderful thing to be able to be with you here today and to return to the Institute after some time now. In fact, though I have been here more recently than this, my very first association, Mike, was some 22 years ago, roughly, when I had first come to Michigan State University as a dean at James Madison College. And we held a seminar out in California, San Clemente, I believe it was, one of the pastors and seminarian seminars. And Bob Sirico asked if I wouldn't be a presenter on that occasion. So we've had frequent occasions since then to work together, and it's all been to my great delight, and not without taking special note of the tremendous progress of the Institute over the course of these 2.5 decades. And what we see here now is such a magnificent accomplishment. I can only come in to commend all of you who've taken part in bringing this to be. You have certainly set down a marker that says that the work of liberty and faith is a work that can thrive in these United States. And so we begin these reflections this afternoon on a very optimistic and high note, one that has been shaped by the efforts of the Acton Institute. And I'm very proud to have even a slight degree of association with them. So yes, today we want to talk about American national character. The full title is Moral Frontiers, American National Character and the Future of Liberty. And this particular set of remarks will be perhaps somewhat abstract in their formulation. So I begin by begging your patience. I want you to bear with me. I think this is a story that is worth telling, even though it requires us to labor somewhat in order to get through it. And that's because we are at some remove from the origins of these things, and we need to refamiliarize ourselves with where we have been. America is a love story, and every true love story is a moral commitment. What is wonderful about true love is the way it expresses that moral commitment. For every lover expects her beloved to be just, not only with her, but in all his dealings, while the beloved affords the lover certain liberties. The final act of justice is the beloved's trust that the lover will make good and faithful use of her liberty. To be more prosaic, let us say that the people and the political union are wedded to each other with mutual expectations of fidelity. This is an odd expression, and it will become apparent as such once you consider the alternative possibility, which is to say that the people are mutually committed to one another, and the political union derives from that collective identification. The formulation I prefer means, therefore, that America is a chosen nation. And as such, the substantial meaning of the choice defines the relationship. The people have made a moral commitment to the choice itself and not merely to one another. That choice is captured in the Declaration of Independence, which imposes moral persuasion as the only ground, the only legitimate grounds of polity, and in turn makes that governance the comprehensive moral foundation of political life. And if, as we come and came to the end of the 20th century, it had turned into an unlovable America, we would have to explain what caused that alienation of affection. Since the substantive choice is insusceptible to change, we'd have to look for a change in the people, pledge to that moral commitment. The American love story began with the Declaration of Independence, but it began to take decisive shape in 1783 when Washington said that we have now a national character to establish. Washington implied that the lovers had to prove themselves worthy of the beloved. The idea, therefore, was that in the decades, indeed the centuries thereafter, the work of building a lasting union was to take place. Nevertheless, 110 years after Washington wrote, Frederick Jackson Turner published The Significance of the Frontier in American History. And he wrote those words you have heard. To the frontier, the American intellect owes its striking characteristics, among which he cites a dominant individualism, working for good and for evil. Missing in this is the beloved object of all this creative energy that Turner had identified. He looked to the closing of the geographical frontier as a watershed for national character. And in the 110 years since, he wrote, we have observed that Washington's project could not be contained in limned geographic descriptions. For we have struggled to define America, let alone our relationship to it. Have we then a national character? And if we do, is it a lover of liberty? Turner's thesis was promptly embraced by the neo-progressives, who sought a new account of America as the foundation for shaping policy in the nation. Franklin Delano Roosevelt encapsulated that process in the 1932 presidential campaign. He summarized the history leading to the closing of the frontier and the challenges that remained. I will quote, "So began in American political life the new day, the day of the individual against the system, the day in which individualism was made the great watchword of American life. The happiest of economic conditions made that day long and splendid. On the western frontier, land was substantially free. No one who did not shirk the task of earning a living was entirely without opportunity to do so. At the very worst, there was always the possibility of climbing into a covered wagon and moving west, where the untilled prairies afforded a haven for men to whom the East did not provide a place." We can now see that the turn of the tide came with the turn of the century. We were reaching our last frontier. There was no more free land, and our industrial combinations had become great, uncontrolled, and irresponsible units of power within the state. Faith in America, faith in our tradition of personal responsibility, faith in our institutions, faith in ourselves demands that we recognize new terms for the old social contract. Now, the original form of this individualism argument that we see in Roosevelt and in Turner appeared in the analysis of Alexis de Tocqueville, who described it as an inward turning that shrinks public space and leaves the citizen at home only within the circle of family and friends. That view seems the predecessor to the contemporary reading of a society in which people adapt the tools of modern communication to build cocoons of like-minded discourse that foreclose the likelihood of consensus-forming accommodation to difference. That is at least the way that Turner prophetically read the history. He said this, "American social development has been continually beginning over again on the frontier. This perennial rebirth, this fluidity of American life, this expansion westward with its new opportunities, its continuous touch with the simplicity of primitive society, furnish the forces dominating American character. But the most important effect of the frontier has been in the promotion of democracy here and in Europe. As has been indicated, the frontier is productive of individualism. Complex society is precipitated by the wilderness into a kind of primitive organization based on the family. The tendency is antisocial. It produces antipathy to control, and particularly to any direct control. The tax gatherer is viewed as a representative of oppression. The frontier conditions prevalent in the colonies are important factors in the explanation of the American Revolution, where individual liberty was sometimes confused with the absence of all effective government." And he concluded, "And now, 4 centuries from the discovery of America, at the end of 100 years of life under the Constitution, the frontier has gone, and with it, with its going, has closed the first period of American history." And I might digress and say, closing that quotation from Turner, that question of the closing of American history has been the question that has remained with us ever since. There have been all too many ready to declare an end to the great experiment in liberty in the United States. Just a few years ago in Israel, Rabbi Pruzansky made the following observation following the election of 2012. The American empire began to decline in 2007, and the deterioration has been exacerbated in the last 5 years. This election only hastens that decline. Society is permeated with sloth, greed, envy, and materialistic excess. It has lost its moorings and its moral foundations. The takers outnumber the givers, and that will only increase in years to come. Across the world, America under Bush was feared but not respected. Under Obama, America is neither feared nor respected. Radical Islam has had a ban of 4 years under Obama, and its prospects for future growth look excellent. The Occupy riots across this country in the last 2 years were mere dress rehearsals for what lies ahead. Years of unrest sparked by the increasing discontent of the unsuccessful who want to seize the fruits and the bounty of the successful and do not appreciate the slow pace of redistribution. Two bright sides, he goes on to say, and he's now talking about Israel. Notwithstanding the election results, I arose this morning, went to shul, davened, and learned Torah afterwards. That is our reality and trumps all other events. Our relationship with God matters more than our relationship with any politician, Republican or Democrat. And notwithstanding the problems in Israel, it is time for Jews to go home to Israel. We have about a decade, perhaps 15 years, to leave with dignity and without stress, thinking that it will always be because it always was, has been a repetitive and deadly Jewish mistake. America was always the land from which positive aliyah came, Jews leaving on their own and not fleeing a dire situation. But that can also change. The increased aliyah in the last few years is partly attributable to young people fleeing the high cost of Jewish living in America. These costs will only increase in the coming years. We should draw the appropriate conclusions. If this election, the election of 2012, proves one thing, it is that the old America is gone. And sad for the world, it is not coming back. The rabbi has a very bleak view of the future of the United States and the character of the people of America. But the rabbi is not alone. As we shall see shortly, others have similarly reflected on the waning of the rising tide that shaped the 18th century, but hardly survived through the 19th century, according to this theory. That first period of our history, according to Turner, was one in which the ideals of equality, freedom of opportunity, faith in the common man were deep-rooted throughout the Middle West and eventually transmitted through the Western frontiers. The frontier stage through which each portion passed left abiding traces on the older as well as on the newer areas of the province. Nor were these ideals limited to the Native American settlers. Germans and Scandinavians who poured into the Middle West sought the country with like hopes and like faith. These transformative effects colored the democracy peculiar to the West. And this is Turner's view of the matter. The peculiar democracy of the frontier has passed away with the conditions that produced it, but the democratic aspirations remain. They are held with passionate determination. The United States is unique in the extent to which the individual has been given an open field, unchecked by restraints of an old social order or of scientific administration of government. Now, what this argument means is that the American national character, derived mainly from the interaction of lives lived under the press of necessity in the context of parsimonious participation by government, beyond highways and rudimentary defense installations, the radical Democrat on the frontier hardly knew the government existed. What that hardy soul fell in love with was the strength of his own arms. Benign neglect on this theory was mistaken for liberty in society. In a more advanced state, approximating the conditions of the Eastern states, this would not avail. Woodrow Wilson drew the conclusion in his work on constitutional government. He said, political liberty consists in the best practicable adjustment between the power of the government and the privilege of the individual, and the freedom to alter the adjustment is as important as the adjustment itself for the ease and progress of affairs and the contentment of the citizen. Political liberty became a privilege or a concession granted by government rather than a right to be claimed against government. From the closing of the frontier, neo-progressives derived problematic conceptions not only of liberty, but of what Turner called the scientific administration of government. A liberty fostered by circumstances rather than national character has only as much influence as the circumstances afford. Moreover, the confusion extended to the understanding of America's place in the world and the landscape of human rights. The emphasis shifted decisively from our relationship with the beloved country to our relationships among ourselves and with others globally, relationships mediated by government. We have a problem. And when we say we mean the citizens of the United States, and still more particularly, those who undertake systematically to explain what constitutes us citizens or a people in the United States. The intuitive sense is scarcely more than a vague geographic sensibility, while a more substantive construction now eludes us almost completely. The problem resides in confusion as to whether what constitutes us a people is a particular moral or political conformation, or rather some less deliberate yet nonetheless evident cultural expression. The problem is that we have become clumsy about describing ourselves as a people in terms of what used to be called national character. For to some, if not many, the idea of character is a loaded term, implying the development of some specific moral or ethical expression that operates as a divisor, separating those attaining the warranted degree of expression from other persons in the United States or elsewhere. Nevertheless, we find it awkward, we find it difficult to speak of our collective existence in any meaningful sense, independently of some such distinguishing function. Our problem, then, is that we desire to be a people, but we hesitate to be a chosen people. A nation of immigrants, we like to say, as if to imply that the immigrants always remain immigrants and never become Americans. Common sense reprehends the very idea, while common practice relies upon it in our most important collective judgments. The problem we have did not emerge in an evolutionary manner as a natural outgrowth of political practice and development. Instead, it derived from a deliberate turning away from the reflexive forms of political discussion that characterized early United States political deliberation. The surest demonstration of this particular turning point or conversion would carry us through a fairly long survey of the discourse employed by a long series of statesmen and public intellectuals from the end of the 19th century to the present era. Fortunately, we can foreshorten that process by relying on the authority of a highly polished and intelligent summary by analysts who take it as their calling to cement the continuing influence of the contemporary progressive conversion in United States politics. And those are the representatives of the neo-progressive option presented through the work of the Center for American Progress. They have published an incredible statement on the meaning of progressivism, which serves the dual purpose of detailing the agenda that is fundamental to neo-progressivism, while at the same time revealing in the most dramatic fashion that element of the original progressive discourse that has been jettisoned in order to accomplish the conversion. To sum up the specific difficulty, and then next to show in detail how it comes to light, we may say at once that the problem is the abandonment of the idea of consent as fundamental to political legitimacy, and substituting in the place of consent a welfare or enjoyment model of political legitimacy. Now, this claim will not be immediately apparent. In order to discover its accuracy, however, one needs only to invoke the true and correct understanding of the Declaration of Independence, and then to interrogate the apology for neo-progressivism on the basis of the Declaration. What will emerge is a clear understanding that neo-progressivism is formulated specifically to replace consent, or the recognition of individual and collective agency as a legitimizing function, with the welfare model, which holds that states are legitimate to the degree that governments extend enjoyments rather than to the extent that they are obedient to the commands of citizens. So let's review the argument from the Center for American Progress. Note that the term consent appears but once in the entire document, and then only in the appendix that reprints the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Moreover, it is instructive that it appears in that document where it does, namely defining the marriage relationship or the confined sphere of individual agency in the new order. At the same time, every discussion of political authority treats government as sui generis and citizens under government as dependents. The will of the people shall be the basis of the authority of government, I quote. This does not suggest that the government originates in the consent of the governed, for the government's authority is a thing apart from the existence of the government. The so-called will of the people has functional relationship in the operation of the government, without for all that constituting the that without which the government cannot legitimately exist. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights, in sum, demotes those natural rights deriving from the laws of nature and of nature's God that are the hallmark of the Declaration of Independence to rights of enjoyment as opposed to agency, the right to a standard of living and security, as I quote, as opposed to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Similarly, the Center for American Progress statement demotes the natural right to life to a civil right that is predicated, in their words, on access to the bare minimum life-sustaining resources. Now, the best context in which to view this dramatic turn is in light of James Wilson's earlier definition of civil rights, namely, rights which are acquired. The citizen, he wrote, is entitled to the honest administration of the government in general. He's entitled in particular to the impartial administration of justice. Now, this account accords well with the movement and the meaning of the Declaration of Independence, which derives civil rights from just powers of government that in turn derive from the consent of the governed. In other words, the Declaration distinguishes the natural rights antecedent to every government and the resultant civil rights that restrain legitimate governments to observing and protecting those natural rights. By insisting on the civil rights while remaining silent about natural rights, the Center for American Progress statement effectively denies the foundations of the Declaration of Independence. The CAP statement takes this still bold position, although Woodrow Wilson had enunciated it long before, 100 years before, for the plain and compelling reason that it believes the political circumstances of the world have so changed as to render inadequate any purely national defense of natural rights. The United States Bill of Rights accordingly must yield to a second Bill of Rights that embraces the rights of humanity, not abstractly, but as a concrete political objective. Now, you may not see this immediately in the express statement from the CAP report. I quote, "The United States was founded on the notion that the government should protect civil and political rights at all cost. These unalienable rights are the truths that the founding fathers held to be self-evident in the Declaration of Independence, that all men are created equal, that they were endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The Bill of Rights is a classic list of these guarantees of freedom and equal treatment under the law," close quotation. Note, however, that the rights enumerated in the Bill of Rights of the United States Constitution were not considered to be guarantees of free and equal treatment under the law, but rather restraints upon government above the law. Thus, what Abraham Lincoln took to be a standard maxim of a free society is to CAP only a notion that government should protect civil and political rights by any means necessary. Or still more clearly, unlimited government power is required to effectuate a notion of civil rights. That is the reason that the CAP statement goes on to say, American progressives have historically understood that political freedoms are empty vessels in the absence of basic life-sustaining resources. People who lack basic access to food, shelter, healthcare, or education cannot fully or even partially enjoy these freedoms. Economic disparities and social discrimination have relegated large swaths of the population to lives of poverty, close quotation. To have a right on this account is to enjoy substantively whatever is denoted by the right. A right to life predicates the enjoyment of means of living, here delineated as covering most basic human activity, food, shelter, healthcare, education. Accordingly, the concept of rights employed by neo-progressives, and civil rights in particular, is the concept of human welfare or flourishing. It is for this reason that we must distinguish the neo-progressives from the original progressives, and that's what George Washington, that's what Abraham Lincoln called themselves, whose focus in the Declaration of Independence lay squarely on individual and collective agency and responsibility for human welfare. Government protected the pursuit of happiness precisely in the form of securing individual and collective agency and responsibility. What this means in sum is that neo-progressives substituted government for America, while the people fell in love not with government, but with America. America is a way of life, not a government. Government is merely America's personal valet. In the neo-progressive model, agency belongs to the government and not to the people. Accordingly, there is less need to defend the efficacy of individual and collective agency, for the people are the beneficiaries rather than the performers of civil rights. In fact, the CAP statement maintains, throughout the 19th and 20th centuries, neo-progressive leaders sought primarily to advance a policy of meeting basic economic and social needs, which are necessary if the principles behind the Bill of Rights are to be realized. The 21st century progeny of these neo-progressives regard this project as elaborating a second Bill of Rights. So let us be clear. What matters to the neo-progressives is to attain not the surface guarantees of the Bill of Rights, but what lies behind the Bill of Rights. The equal and impartial administration of justice, for example, is realized not in procedures of fairness, but in outcomes that may be empirically described as fair. All of this re-rendering of the founding of the United States takes place, as previously suggested, in a new context in which human rights are to be protected not for this or that particular people, but rather for people in general, for people globally. If this attainment is achievable and understandable only in the context of empirically describable outcomes, then it follows that the idea of human rights for the neo-progressive is rather a that toward which we strive, as opposed to a that without which all striving is illegitimate. Although this argument could have been induced from the principles of Woodrow Wilson or Franklin Roosevelt or Jimmy Carter or Barack Obama, the Center for American Progress statement preferred to pose it as deriving from the creation of the United Nations and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. They said, a new global consensus emerged after the world collapsed into chaos, aggression, and mass slaughter during World Wars I and II. Interesting that they would describe it that way rather than victory, but to go on. That lasting peace required the protection of individual rights and freedoms in all countries. Although the work of securing true liberty and equality for all presents numerous diplomatic, humanitarian, and military difficulties, it remains the duty of progressives to defend these ideals and to help turn them into reality for people everywhere. Moreover, they're not done yet. Progressives have argued for years that the United States' own security interests are better met by relying upon global political consensus international human rights precedents and American human rights laws in response to such national security threats. Close quotations. Now, it is neither the case that the justification for this demand is purely tactical or prudential. For the neo-progressives maintain that human rights are derived in part from the consensus of the international community. That is to say, the opinions of international policymakers is the source of rights, in place of that rational opinion that confirms the correct identification of human rights. The latter, of course, was the standard enunciated in the Declaration of Independence, when its framers submitted facts to a candid world for whose opinions they had a decent respect. A global political consensus bespeaks rather a global or international authority as a legitimate exponent and responsible agent that realizes human rights. That is an evolving standard, which the Center for American Progress regards as a more flexible approach to human rights that offers the possibility of reconciling new understandings of human rights with a new and changing world. Naturally, there must follow from the redefinition of civil rights a redefinition of state sovereignty, since the new order must protect the good governance values that precipitated the founding of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, based on progressive commitments to dignified life, liberty, and security for all people across the globe, not on the supremacy of state powers. The separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God, entitled the American Revolutionaries, ceases to be the foundation for a guarantee of human rights in the eyes of neo-progressives. Since the realization of human rights depends upon their global realization, there can no longer be a defense of the notion that one people might realize what other peoples must perforce live without. Civil and political rights include the rights to life, liberty, freedom of association, fair and equal treatment under the law. Economic, social, and cultural rights are made up of such fundamental needs as the right to food, decent living conditions, education, and basic health care. Together, these two sets of rights make up the universal, indivisible, and interdependent and interrelated list of basic human rights entitlements recognized under international law. That completes the portrait. Rights that U.S. citizens long have celebrated as a source of their liberties have been reconstituted as an obligation to bring not liberty, but welfare entitlements to the people of the globe. On those terms, America is not beloved as a substantive moral commitment. It is at best a useful tool to seek a remoter goal. America cannot be the object of our affection when global happiness hangs in the balance. Neither, therefore, can national character describe our moral attainments or commitments. What then becomes of liberty when detached from national character? Carl Scott recently published an intelligent discussion of the five meanings of liberty, and we can discover in that discussion the missing link in these developments, namely the moral imperatives present at the outset of the American love story. Scott identified natural rights liberty, community self-governance liberty, economic autonomy liberty, social justice liberty, and personal autonomy liberty as the five concepts. Next, he explained how dominant neo-progressive thought had compressed the five into the last two as the meaningful political or policy concepts of liberty. This makes sense of the contemporary discourse, which treats liberty as enjoyment rather than as moral agency. However, this five-fold typology does not well capture the founding meaning of liberty, which, far from invoking morally indifferent personal autonomy, embraced self-government as a personal moral obligation rather than as a collective practice. The protection of natural rights was indeed the protection of the right of self-government or consent. And it is in that light alone that the right to liberty leads to a right of revolution. None of Scott's five meanings taken alone can rationally ground the right of revolution, which reveals their inadequacy as explanations of liberty, however ably they characterize contemporary discourse. But Scott captures eloquently the neo-progressive transformation that led to obscuring the right of revolution, and hence the true understanding of liberty. And this is what he writes. What the progressives and the New Deal liberals feared, however, was that older American dogmas would keep the nation's democracy from directing its own social development as they envisioned. They found two dogmas particularly regrettable. The first was what they broadly denounced as individualism, by which they basically meant economic autonomy, liberty. Progressives traced the roots of this individualism to the founding itself, but many of them put more of the blame upon economic theories of later origin. Either way, while such individualism has been a useful creed for pioneer farmers and small-town merchants to hold, the modern economy was increasingly coming to be divided into corporations and wage earners. There was no longer a frontier where one could carve out property by mixing one's labor into the land in the manner extolled by Lockean theory. Thus, belief in inviolable individual rights, and particularly the rights to contract and use properly freely, actually served to further entrench the power of corporations against that of individuals, close quotation. Now, how this cashes out in our time is that we experience a crabbed politics in which claims of moral rights are translatable only as claims for governmental intervention rather than as assertions of unalienable rights. This was evident decades ago in the campaign for a school prayer amendment. It is more evident today in the campaign to defend traditional marriage through governmental recognition. When a robust assertion of rights would withdraw from all recognition of state power in this regard, a more tenuous claim of rights as governmental privileges petitions for political recognition. Yet nothing could be clearer than that the sure path to defend holy matrimony, what after all is traditional marriage among eons of various traditions, the sure path to defend holy matrimony is by severing all connection with the state in relation to it. The temptation of Philadelphia Archbishop Charles Chaput to surrender his civil license is the correct response to state-enforced same-sex marriage. I could even imagine public protest of citizen couples burning their marriage licenses on courthouse steps to reclaim the moral high ground in defense of holy matrimony. The liberty that derives, that drives the American love story, derives from self-government as present at the founding, not as a communitarian value, but as a core moral theory, positioning the individual to act as a rights-bearing agent. Therefore, it is out of sync with what Scott identifies as central today. He said, it has also become clear that many Americans now regard this individual autonomy notion of liberty as a central feature of our democratic heritage. To every appearance, therefore, moral frontiers have emerged at which we undergo character-structuring influences no less dramatic than those heretofore attributed to geographic frontiers. These moral frontiers, decision points at which Americans must rely upon themselves and not on government to steer their course, may be variously accounted for. In the main, though, we may safely affirm that they have always been present. In the first century under the Constitution, it was not so much the primitive wilderness that shaped national character as the fact that the hardy pioneers always had, hard on their heels, parsons and educators determined to wield moral influence. If they were self-reliant individuals, it was as much because they accepted responsibilities as because they were left to their own devices. In this sense, therefore, the existence of the moral frontier is a recurring phenomenon and not a new one. It colored the American love story through the end of slavery and Lincoln's helmsmanship. Can it also see America through the era of moral and/or cultural disintegration we now observe? To some, the upsurge in cultural variation is critical. Samuel Huntington counted it as posing the potential end of American history even before Rabbi Prusinski. He meant that national character has undergone irreversible changes under the pressures to integrate widely varying cultural perspectives. But is that so? It is easy to mistake a moment of trenchant political or policy decision in which compromise is the essence of prudent management with an inflection point in which adherence to an absolute moral criterion is essential. It may be difficult as a matter of practice to accommodate enormous numbers of immigrants, but that does not rule out a compromise bottomed on fundamental terms of justice and thus coherent with the American love story. It seems rather that what would mortally injure American liberty would be such an inflection point as one in which citizens surrendered fundamental moral principle instead of resisting its abandonment. To that end, moral persuasion remains the fundamental tool, and wise statesmanship remains the best hope. We might better seek guidance for such purposes at a greater remove from our felt necessities, and therefore I will conclude by pointing to such a guide in the form of Xenophon's Agesilaus. Agesilaus, whose very name means the people's guide. Xenophon's Agesilaus celebrates a monarch and serves as an example of possible interpretations of the significance of national character. This king, Spartan king, Agesilaus, was said to have formed his soul so as to be impregnable to money, voluptuous pleasures, and fear. Xenophon distinguished Agesilaus' justice, his courage or wisdom, and moderation or continence from the virtues of piety and patriotism. By bringing the reach of the former virtues within the range of a monarch's will, Xenophon elevated them, at least insofar as what is both good for us and accessible to us is higher than what is merely good. Agesilaus put his virtues to good use, or properly fared well on account of his virtues. They showed the political image of a Socrates. Xenophon revived the opening question of his work, concluding in chapter 10 that Agesilaus is rightly believed to be a completely good man. The closing chapter, the summary, completed the account of that complete goodness. He was in awe of the gods, even among enemies, and in awe of what gods could do for men, hence his piety. After the first half of the summary, the gods vanish. From paragraph 9 to the end, the reader revels in the man, the monarch, for whom the good he could himself do, the moral commitment, was an obsession. Xenophon's praise of Agesilaus takes seriously Agesilaus' purported concern for the common good. A 20th century Xenophon, by contrast, would have interpreted these same characteristics in light of a mere attempt to gain influence over others for the sake of some hidden agenda. Why then should we afford old-fashioned Xenophon's naivete any credibility? If we look again, we will note that old-fashioned Xenophon was not uncritical. In chapter 2, he allowed that there might be some other way in which one could find fault with Agesilaus's apparently confusing the common good of Sparta, a national good, and the common good of Greece, a transnational good. Yet he discerned an ultimate objective which he judged to be the controlling factor in Agesilaus's mind, and which in any case serves to bring us to reflect on the virtue and paradox of friendship as the aim of politics. Friendship as an end both necessitates and undermines justice, that same justice which the beloved has a right to expect from the lover, and vice versa. Defined by Aristotle as the preference of another's good, friendship in its ideal expression is the relationship among all citizens and something to be aimed at in legal arrangements. But the stronger that passion, the more possible it is that someone might prefer a friend's good to the city's good. And there's a bigger problem to which Xenophon points in chapter 7. So listen. Well then, a messenger came to him with news that in the Corinthian battle, 8 Spartans had died while nearly 10,000 of the adversaries. He did not become evidently delighted, but he said then, "Alas for you, O Greece, when the perish were sufficient of living to win in a fight against all the barbarians." Indeed, when the Corinthian refugees said that they would give over the city to them and made a display of the machine with which they were looking to take the wall, he still did not wish to throw his forces against it, saying that it was not necessary to bring the Greek cities to slavery, but to their prudence. If we annihilate those of us who err, we must see that we are not left with no one to overpower the barbarian. Again, if it is good to be a hater of the Persian, because of old he set forth in order to enslave Greece, and presently he forms alliances with whomsoever will do the greatest mischief, gives presents to whomever would, receiving them do special evil to the Greeks, and would join in helping any peace through which he accounts we will make war with each other, all men see this. But who, except Agesilaus, ever made it his business that any community should revolt from the Persian, or that the revolted should not be cut off, or that the king suffering evil will not be able to give trouble to the Greeks? Who, when his fatherland made war against the Greeks, nevertheless did not neglect the common good of Greece? Here, Xenophon showed Agesilaus' elevation of soul by revealing that he could consider the national good of Sparta as compatible with the good of other peoples. The problem of every regime, the necessity of exclusivity, is overcome by a large ability to relate the end of the city to the human end. True to the wildest imaginings of Socrates, it is the political philosopher Xenophon who enables us to consider this question in a way which is far more fruitful than merely to assume universality or common humanity. With this example in mind, let us return then to America's Agesilaus, George Washington. His national character project spoke not only of the American character to be established. In the letter to Theodoric Bland, he added, "And it is of the utmost importance to stamp favorable impressions upon our national character. Let justice then be one of its characteristics and gratitude another." In the circular address, he also described the context in which that character was to be established and to serve as a guarantor for liberty and self-government. That context was the expectation of justice. He phrased it thus: "The path of our duty is plain before us. Honesty will be found on every experiment to be the best and only true policy. Let us then, as a nation, be just. Let an attention to the cheerful performance of their proper business as individuals and as members of society be earnestly inculcated on the citizens of America. Then will they strengthen the hands of government and be happy under its protection. Everyone will enjoy," Washington said, "the fruit of his labors. Everyone will enjoy his own acquisitions without molestation and without danger." And then he capped it all off: "In this state of absolute freedom and perfect security, who will grudge to yield a very little of his property to support the common interests of society and ensure the protection of government?" Washington famously closed the circular address with a tacit quotation from Micah 6:8, which read as follows: "I now make it my earnest prayer that God would be pleased to dispose us all to do justice, to love mercy, and to demean ourselves with that charity, humility, and pacific temper of mind which were the characteristics of the divine author of our blessed religion, and without an humble imitation of whose example in these things, we can never hope to be a happy nation." As Washington experienced it, the American love story was a love of justice, a story of Americans asserting themselves with expectations of justice in America's dealings. He made the future of the country to depend upon the conduct of his people, the use of whose liberty would determine how far the nation could remain faithful. Something of the same order of consideration was still present in 1964 when Ronald Reagan spoke of the war against communism and said, "If we lose this way of freedom of ours, history will record with the greatest astonishment that those who had the most to lose did the least to prevent its happening." That sentiment is exactly what Abraham Lincoln meant when he declared in his 1854 Peoria speech that if there's anything which it is the duty of the whole people to never entrust to any hands but their own, that thing is the preservation and perpetuation of their own liberties and institutions. After the passage of more than two centuries, a consensus of the best has emerged. The future of liberty depends upon American national character and whether it sustains a single-minded commitment to America as a substantive moral expression. A cloudless future for liberty would mean that Americans are falling in love again. Question?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Allen. Thought-provoking. We have time for questions, so if you have a question, just raise your hand. This microphone works best when you speak right into the top of it, so don't speak to the side. Speak right to the top. Thank you.
Would you agree, Dr. Allen, that process you've described is one of human nature, of the fall in human nature spoken of in Genesis 3, where man wants to know good and evil. Man wants to make the decision of what's right and wrong, what's good and evil, and do not want to rely on God, which our founders, they established rights that were given to us by God, but today, We've fallen away from that. We've lost our moral compass, and we want to decide what's right and wrong. And I mean, where do you find a woman's right to have an abortion? Where does that come from? It's not found in the Word of God. It's found in the ideas of man.
I couldn't agree more heartily with you. I think it is true that what we have witnessed is a loss of that inner compass that once was more visibly present among the people of this society and other societies, because there was a sufficient discipline, orientation towards God. But I want to remind us that this is not new in the order of the universe. There was certainly never any people who had more reason to walk in the way of God than the people of Israel. And as the opening of Psalm 119 reminds us, the pathway was clear, and it was to walk in the law. And yet, in the face of all that clarity, time and again, they walked the other way. So this human inclination to invent our own orientation rather than to follow that which has been given to us, granted us even, has been the source of numerous troubles and difficulties. And I'm not a Pollyanna. I'm not going to suggest that we cannot, as Huntington thought, as Rabbi Pruzanski thought, that we cannot fall so hard that we never get up again. But I'm not there yet. I still think there's room for us to reassert the strength of national character in this country. And that means to reassert our faith in God. Yes. Yes. Quite so, and of course, those of us who are in the pulpits now and who constantly are faced with this challenge are daily reminding ourselves to speak up and not to bite our tongues. We know what the pressure is like. We understand the pressure of political correctness that has certainly hobbled the tongues of many. But there are still those who will take the time to speak up and who will rise to the challenge. So what I'm relying upon is that God's grace has not yet been removed from us, that that hand still is on this nation.
Thank you for giving us hope. There's a man called Whitaker Chambers, as you remember.
Yes.
I'm leaving the winning side and joining the losing side.
Yes.
When he walked away from communism.
Right.
Communism, socialism. And among us old people, who remember that well, your speech today gave us hope.
Well, thank you so much.
Dr. Allen, really appreciate the structure you used of love and of talking about it as a relationship. I think we so easily forget that when we think of love, you know, love of our children, love of our spouse, we didn't think about rights at those times. We thought about service or connection or being with that person. This was the primary driving force. We weren't concerned. It seems that somehow the founding fathers understood this power of love, this connection. And now what we're seeming to be into is a contractual arrangement.
Yes.
A contractual situation in which I get and you get. And it's not, it seems that it's not surprising that we're not satisfied with that. What led you to use this as your rubric, as your unifying force, the whole relationship of love?
God almighty. It was pure inspiration, the divine hand was upon that. Just to be perfectly frank with you, the broader remarks had been structured in my mind for some time, and they represent, of course, the accumulation of years of study and reflection. But the organization, the mode of presentation, was something that I did not have until I was visited by God with an express revelation that this is what it's about. So that's what I've said.
Amen. Yes, thank you, Dr. Allen. So the Center for American Progress would probably agree that the consensus should be, an international consensus, which would be a humanistic consensus.
Right.
Seems implausible here in the United States that we've gone so far as to, one side of the country adopting that, the other still yearning back for the Washington statement for consensus of character. So my thinking through this and my question would be, does the church have a consensus? Does the body of Christ have a consensus? And if it does, how can at least the body of Christ, gain power from that consensus? And if it doesn't, how can the body of Christ then at least, with the church, develop a consensus upon which at least we can operate out of and have a character that is born from Christ?
Well, you ask a very difficult question, of course. A question as to where the churches are. And I say churches deliberately because I'm thinking now of the church at Laodicea, which has forgotten its first love. So we always want to distinguish the churches from the church of Christ, from Christ's church, from the true church, the Holy Catholic Church, so to speak. There is a consensus, which is the word of Christ, and which is the only possible ground of consensus in the true church. But among the churches, there are, of course, as many varieties of opinion as we find resonant in the society at large. And so the task is to bring the churches under the consensus of the church. Now, that's not an easy task, is it? But it's something, of course, we attempt, we work at. And so long as we are faithful to our call, we will entrust to Him to produce the proper harvest.
Dr. Allen, thank you for this compelling articulation of the connection between personal and corporate character and the public order. Based on this connection, is it true that people get the government that they deserve?
Yes. Well, it is true. It is true that it's usually lapse in the attention of the people that leads to lapses in government. I would say in that sense, yes, people get the government they deserve. But I will want to be more generous, ultimately. I can never forget Washington. Washington said, which we didn't quote in the remarks in that circular address, that this is the people's time of probation. So we have a national character to be established, and the question is, will we establish it? This is our period of probation. So Washington understood that people would undergo testing. And I suspect that by the period of probation, he didn't mean only the first decade or two under the Constitution. I suspect that Washington could conceive of people being repeatedly under probation as they try to live out the promise of their political institutions. And so what I would say is that during those probationary times, we are perhaps less strong than we are when we take our moral commitment in full tide. But it is still possible to work towards it. We can still inculcate. I still believe that there will be that assertion of responsibility that will reclaim the true character of this nation before all is done, before all is said and done. So we may have the political leaders for the moment we deserve because of inattention, but the government, which is more than the political leaders, is something, of course, which is still conformed to the original design, by and large.
Dr. Allen, thank you very much. There's about 15 questions I want to ask, so I'm just going to ask two. One is a larger question. Perhaps you could comment on, you know, we have a lot of Protestants quoting the Bible. I'm a Catholic. We wrote the Bible, but we haven't read it. So I'm going to quote the Pope instead. So Joseph Ratzinger, Benedict XVI, in one of his first addresses after being made Bishop of Rome, what's the Regensburg Address, which you may know.
I do know.
He one of the things you talked about in your talk, I think, he says that fundamentally one of the characters of America is moral persuasion. And then you know all of the readings from the Center for American Progress. Benedict or Joseph Ratzinger's, you know, worry or critique is that in the West we have a crisis of reason, right? And he said that we have relegated reason merely to the empirical. So questions about justice, truth, beauty, goodness, right, wrong, compassion, hope, friendship, love, are all outside the realm of reason. And he said specifically, politics is about reason. Mm-hmm. He said politics is about justice, as you said, and it's in the realm of reason.
Yes.
These are kind of paraphrasing of him. So the first question is, how do we recover, or what do we do? What are your thoughts on this crisis of reason, which makes moral persuasion impossible because it becomes sentiment or power? That's the first. And then the second one is perhaps related, is one of the things you talked about is these new rights in a new time. And what we're seeing now is a redefinition of the concept of human dignity. Human dignity is a changing essence that comes from the government, and that comes based on what you could call a plastic anthropology, right? You have this existentialist ability to determine yourself in LGBTQ or whatever it might be. And once you've done, that's who you are. And who you are is more important than what you hold. So if I am something
and you hold certain religious beliefs, your religious beliefs become trumped by my essential structure as whatever I've defined myself. So this kind of changing of rights and the lack of reason, how do you think we address some of these things? I know those are big questions, but you have a big mind.
Those are big questions. To take the first question and place the rights in abeyance for a moment, I think that's the easier question for us to deal with, the question of how is it we recover confidence in reason. We have a straight path to that in the United States, at least, and that's the Declaration of Independence. The purpose, the bearing of the Declaration is to commit us to the life of reason, for its entire structure and meaning is that we must use the standard of reason in order to establish legitimate government. Now, insofar as we can call ourselves back to that declaration, we can always recover what has become, and the Pope was quite right about that, the abandonment of reason in the period following the mid-19th century through the 20th century. Yes, it's true. Reason's powers had come to be restricted because we began to believe that all the fundamental things were merely subjective, that there was no truth about the moral order, the order of reality which defines us in our being. But, of course, the Declaration denies that. The Declaration begins with the assertion that the human being is a being that exists in a way that is knowable by human beings and knowable to human reason, that we cannot therefore deny the rational component while still clinging to the moral component. All men are created equal means what? It means that we know a human being when we see a human being. No one is born to rule another without the other's consent. Well, those are not simply self-actuating principles. Those are principles which have their actuating power as a consequence of reason. A consequence of the language of the Declaration is to say self-evident truth. Well, what do we mean by self-evident truth? We don't mean that it's evident to every self. That is not the point of that particular construction. The point is that the truth is contained within the terms of the proposition itself. So that there is no demonstration outside of the proposition. That's what makes it a self-evident truth. But that's a rational formulation, and it is an appeal to power of the mind, the power of the human mind that is native to the human being as such. Yes, human beings have differing levels of intellectual capacity, but that's not germane to this foundation. The foundation is there for every human being. So apart from any particular disorder that someone might suffer, to be human is to be able to grasp that all men are created equal, that none is therefore born by nature the ruler of another. You need reason to do that. You need reason, therefore, to actuate the claims of justice which derive from that recognition. That this political community is thus structured, and in that way, unlike any other political community that we know, means that it always has a pathway back to reason, even in an age in which reason has been spurned. And so what I would suggest, and I think this is compatible with the Regensburg Address, by the way, is that we have a tool to use to re-burnish reason in this era in which it has been spurned, and that is to go back to the Declaration, to bring forward the political claims, the political argument in their rational foundation, and not allow them to be diminished or dismissed. Now, that's not unrelated to your second question. How is it in the age of self-identification, which therefore means in which we deny that there is an essence, that there is a human nature, how are we to respond to those claims? What is true authority? Well, as I suggested, though it didn't go into great detail in the course of my formal remarks. The authority comes in the acceptance of moral responsibility first and foremost. And that's an acceptance which is not predicated on answering to another, but answering to oneself. One must experience the moral obligation, the moral commitment. Now, to merely define oneself is not to acquire a moral obligation. Therefore, you have to ask yourself, in this world of infinite alphabets, what comes with the alphabet you choose for yourself? You can push that question. What are you obliged to do or not to do? Now, we tend to talk today as if there are no obligations upon us. There are only duties that others owe to us. that we're entitled, but we're not obligated to do anything. But of course, we recognize that that argument isn't going to last very long if we simply push. Surely, if you say you are X, then X must be something. What is it that X is and must do? And in light of what do we find X? In other words, we have room for discourse, room for inquiry. We have room to challenge, to interrogate. We don't have to accept simply because the claims are made. So I would say, I don't find the disorder from this chaotic appeal to infinite rights to be that paralyzing. I think that it is susceptible to being directly challenged and will yield because there isn't anything there to push. It's really a Potemkin village. Lean on it with the least pressure and it will tumble. So that would be my response in that regard. Okay.
We have time for one more question. Dr.
Allen, thank you very much for your wonderful address. I was thinking about the question of homesteading on the frontier.
Yes.
Which in a sense is a government grant to the poor, but it somehow elevates the agency of the yeah. benefactor. Then I think of federal housing, how it could have been conceived all along in the same way, that after 5 years you own that beautiful apartment in downtown Manhattan and you're a millionaire. Is there room in a kind of in the vision that you've presented where we've got to be self-reliant for that kind of homesteading in our current situation? What would it look like? Or just any thoughts you have on how we help people in a way that elevates their agency and doesn't diminish it? Thank you.
Well, excellent question. You know, there have been some modest urban homesteading attempts in recent years trying to deal with the problem of urban blight. It hasn't gone very far. I think it's been minimally engaged in Chicago, one or two other places. But you're right to draw the sharp contrast between public housing that is built and is periodically destroyed because it's maintained in such a manner that it can't be maintained. And so we have to go in and tear them down because they become warrens of disorder and social dysfunction. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could have a homesteading mentality? But that would take a government which saw itself as servant. You see. That's what would be required. The mentality you must change first is to change that mentality of government itself, where the government really is servant or personal valet, as I said before, rather than a government which thinks that it is the source of all goodness and all order in the universe. When we did homesteading in the 19th century, the government was actually leveraging the abilities of individuals to accomplish an important social purpose. We don't think that way anymore. With the welfare entitlement theory, we don't leverage the abilities of individuals. We merely find ways to provide for them superficially what we identify as their needs without much intervention on their part to define even what they need. So you need a different mindset. You need to think that if these people are there, if there are purposes to be served by invoking their participation, how to invoke their participation. If that means homesteading, then we'll do homesteading. Give ownership, because that gives, of course, care, attendance. That gives the love. That makes it work. So yes, I quite agree with you. I would love to see us engage in some of our poverty efforts in a very different approach to that, where we entrusted people to get themselves out of difficult circumstances through whatever powers they could bring to bear. And if we could, in some small way, give leverage to permit that, then that is what we should be doing.
Please join me in thanking again Dr. Bill Allen.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.